to give you a bit of background on why I'm here and what my story is all about, I went to 3 national schools and 2 secondary schools, moved around between Dublin and Galway, was never kicked out of school, that's not why I moved so much, just with family circumstances we had to move, and I guess I had to adapt very fast to make friends really quickly. And all through school I was always involved in sport, public speaking, I loved all my subjects, I really actually loved going to school, got on with teachers, got on with everyone. And I think Aoife Dooley touched on it earlier, how, you know, to speak to everyone in school, and no matter where I went in school, it didn't matter if you were in first year, second year, third year, so on, I always said hello to people, especially sometimes when you walk around doing a lap at the school and you'd see a student sitting alone by themselves eating their lunch. I used to always go out of my way to say hello to that person because, you know, you just don't know what anyone's going through. And I suppose in school I was probably very guilty of this because I constantly went around with a big smile on my face and I was always happy. And people used to always say to me, "You're always so happy." And I was like, "Yeah, I am, sure, why wouldn't I be?" But what I was hiding was something much deeper and much greater. And the story I'm going to tell you today is going to resonate with some of you in this room right now and will resonate with others of you in time to come. What I would say will relate to quite a lot of people as well. There's a few different aspects I'm going to touch on. So I went through secondary school kind of burying everything that was going on and pushing it down and down and down, and I thought if I just stay ignoring it, it might disappear. I went on to the University of Limerick to study An Ghaeilge, agus na Meáin Úra, which is Irish and New Media. I always loved Ghaeilge. I used to live in Spittal for a couple of years as well, so that's where that came about. And went down to UL, and again, it was a new university, new friends, new chapter, so I stayed pushing down and down everything that I was hiding deep down inside. And as the years went on, I could feel it coming closer and closer, but I just said, you know what, I'm just going to stay ignoring it, and I can't see it, and stay smiling and stay being happy, and no one's going to know any different. Then I went on to do a master's in journalism in NUI Galway, and that's where it finally caught up with me. And I couldn't run anymore. It was like when you fill a bottle, and I was trying to keep it closed, but it was actually a bursting point. And eventually, during that year, it exploded. And I remember that morning I woke up, and I was beyond devastated. I couldn't go into my lectures anymore. I couldn't smile anymore. A friend said to me, she was like, "The sparkle is gone from your eyes," and I knew it was. I couldn't get out of bed in the mornings. Everything just felt so heavy and so dark. And there was one particular morning, as I mentioned, and I was crying and crying and crying, and I couldn't get off the floor. I was in my apartment. All my friends were gone to college, and I remember the pain and the tears were so heavy and strong that I was actually stuck to the floor. I couldn't physically pick myself up because the weight of what I was feeling was that strong. So I had to call my mother, and Pauline's over here today, and she came into me and she picked me up and she sat me down and she said, "Right, this is it. It's time now. You have to face what went on in the past." And I knew deep down that I couldn't escape this any longer, and I had to in fact deal with what was going on. And that was grief and loss. And what I haven't told you yet was when I was 15 years old on the 5th of March, I just finished my junior cert mocks, and I'd come home and my dad and I were planning to go horse riding together, and my brother Marcus had just finished his leaving cert mocks and he was going off to rugby training, and we were a very sporty household. And I got home from horse riding and I noticed that something wasn't right. My mother was distressed and she said, "Something's happened." While my brother and his friend were driving home from rugby training, sadly, there was a car crash and both the boys died. Our neighbour and our friend, who was the driver, and then my brother Marcus, who was the passenger. So as you can imagine, my older brother, my best friend, he was very protective of me. Anytime I went out to a disco, it wasn't my dad who checked my outfit, it was my brother. And he'd look at me and he'd be like, "Take that skirt, that, change that, you're not wearing that skirt. Ma'am, make up on trousers, she's not going out like that." So he was much like a father figure as well. And we studied together and we did so much together, we were extremely close. So as you can imagine, losing my brother, my best friend, was just devastating, and the grief that followed was just awful. But I had a mother and a father who were, their grief was incomprehensible. Like, there's nothing, and I'll never try to compete with a mother's grief. But at the end of the day, I had lost my brother and I had lost my friend too. But I decided at that moment that I want to look after my parents. My dad then had health complications all throughout my life, but he was like the bionic man. Nothing would ever stop him. No matter how bad the hospital visit was, Dad always came out and we'd go off and go take the horses around the country. But after my brother's death, I think my dad kind of almost felt this guilt that he had cheated death so many times, and yet in one foul swoop, due to speed, my brother was killed. In 2006, my dad, Maxie, sadly lost his battle and he died as well. So 2 weeks after my dad passed away, I had to go into my leave and cert year, and I couldn't believe it. I genuinely was like, this can't be happening, but it was happening, and it did happen. So I went into leave and cert, and I said, I'm just going to put my head down. I want to go to UL. I want to study Irish in media, so I'm just going to pretend that this didn't happen to me, and I'll just carry on. And as I said, I just kept pushing the grief down and down and down, and I wasn't telling anyone what I was feeling. I actually was crying myself to sleep at night, and I was writing in this diary, keeping a note of how sad and lonely I was. But then at school, I wasn't telling anyone what was really going on, which I probably should have. I should have opened up to my friends and said, look, I'm really sad. So then when I was in the during my master's, when I realized I was grieving, I went into the library and I found a book by Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, and that's where I learned about the five stages of grief, which you can see on the board. Shock, obviously, shock is what happens when someone initially passes away, and it's that shock that they've died, you can't believe it. Then you're in denial, you're thinking, this hasn't happened. He's going to walk back in that door, you know, I'm going to hear the rugby match on the TV, I'm going to smell the Hugo Boss around the house. That's denial. Anger then is the stage where obviously it's anger, where you're really angry at everything. You're angry at life, you're angry at your family, you're angry at your friends. Maybe your friends don't understand, and you just go through these so many emotions. Then you go on to the sadness or depression stage, where obviously you're really low, and that's what happened to me during my master's. I was just really sad and I was really empty. But then acceptance is the next stage. It's where you accept what happened to you and you can learn how to smile and be happy again. And that stage is very much so achievable. We can all get to acceptance. And to be honest, during my master's, I thought I was never going to get to that stage. I thought, how am I ever going to get through this? But I realized then that when I had to deal with my brother, my father's death, I also had to deal with something that happened when I was in national school. And that was my parents separating. My parents separated when I was 5 years old, so suddenly I had to deal with that as well. And I think at the time I thought I was okay with my parents not being together anymore, but it was when I was going through the loss of Marcus and Dad's death that's when the old feelings came back again, and I had to go through all that, and the denial of my parents not being together and trying to pretend at school that, you know, my dad worked away. You know, you become like this rugby ball between two parents, and it can get quite messy. So the thing about grief as well, I'll go back to the stages, the five stages of grief can be applied to so many different aspects of your life. It's not just about death. It could be about separation and divorce. It could be about a breakup with your best friend. It could be about a breakup with your boyfriend or girlfriend. It could be about the death of a pet as well. These can be applied to so many avenues of your life. When you fail an exam, if you don't get the college course, but just remember that everything happens for a reason. Another thing that I experienced and want to touch on today is panic attacks and anxiety. I know a lot of people talk about them. I experienced my first panic attack when I was 4 years old, but it turns out it was around the time that my parents were separating. Obviously, at the time, I didn't know what it was. As I grew up through life, I had a few different experiences with them, but again, I never knew what they were. It was only when I started studying grief and loss that I realized what was really going on. And it was all linked back to my parents' separation, my brother's death, and my father's death. And I had to kind of really look deep inside to realize that that was the root of my panic attacks and my anxiety. So then I had to figure out how to get to the stage acceptance, how to deal with the panic attacks, how to deal with anxiety, because I wanted to go on and do journalism. I wanted to work in the media, and I knew that I needed to kind of sort out everything that was going on inside, and I had to get back to that happy place so that I could become and work in the industry that I'm now working in. Meditation is something that was brought into my life along with yoga, and I have to say, I did yoga for a few years. It was absolutely incredible, but I kept shying away from it. And just recently I went back into it, and I can't get over how powerful it is and how amazing just doing simple stretches can open up certain parts of your inner body as well. Meditation is something that can be quite difficult to get into, but something simple as going on YouTube and searching meditation music and just letting it play in the background, even while you're studying or something, or, you know, getting ready for an exam, just have the meditation music on, because it has a way of relaxing you. Writing obviously was massive for me. I kept diaries from when my brother died, and I found that it was very hard to talk to people and share my experience. Like, of course I can say, oh, just talk to someone, but it can be, when you're in that position, it is quite hard to do. So start writing things down. Get pen and paper. Don't write things down on a laptop or on a phone. Get the old pen and paper out and get and physically write down exactly what you're feeling, and get it all down on pen and paper, because eventually that will help you talk to someone, writing first. Reading as well. I know it's hard these days to read, but, you know, try see if you can find a book that you like, or, you know, stay searching through books and you'll find one that you connect with. Obviously talking is a massive one. Don't be afraid to look for help and ask for help. I know Pieta House are here, and I actually ended up in Pieta House a couple of years ago because I was found it all too overwhelming, and I knew that I needed professional help. And never be ashamed to ask for professional help, because they're there for a reason. There are so many people out there that are trained to help you. And do your research as well. Like, I found researching grief and loss became hugely beneficial to me, and I got to learn so much about myself, and also got to learn about so many great people out there that have written so many great things about grief and loss. And finally, I want to leave you with two little things to do. Smiling and gratitude. So try your best to smile every single day. And I know sometimes you really don't feel like smiling, but just try, think of something that makes you happy. And then on a little piece of paper, write down the things that make you smile. For example, my dog, my cat, they actually just bring me so much joy. And even if you want, put it into a wallet or into your pencil case. So the things that make you happy. And if you're not feeling great, if you're in the class and you're feeling a bit down, pull out the piece of paper and remind yourselves of the things that make you happy. Practice gratitude every day. When you wake up, say the things that you're grateful for, the things you're happy for. It can be something as simple as a roof over your head, the food on your table, your family, your friends. It could be anything at all, something so small that just brings you such happiness. And finally, the touch test. If you ever feel like you're having a panic attack or anxiety is just getting too much, it's a simple touch test. It's touching something and reminding yourself you're here. So just even if you're sitting on the chair right now, if you just touch that chair, it grounds you and makes you realize where you are. You're right here, you're in Dublin, you're at Zeminar. So as I said, after I got through the stage of acceptance, I know my time is up, I went on to get my master's in journalism. I went on to work in MTV in London for a year and a half, which was a really cool experience. I am now presenting my own show called The Limerick Post Show. It's an online show. I present on Classic Hits Radio every weekend. And as of yesterday, I now work for The Today Show with Dahi and Mora as a panelist. So all I'll say is never give up on your dreams. No matter how bad or low times and things get, remember that there is acceptance and there is something bigger and greater out there for you, and never ever give up on who you are. Thank you very much.